In this video, I'm going to show you how to import film scans into DaVinci Resolve. These techniques are applicable whether you're working with 8, 16, or 35mm film. Each roll of film scanned will be delivered to you as a single movie clip, regardless of how many times you stopped or started the camera. We'll cover how to deal with the formats that scans are delivered in, how to break those large clips into individual shots, and how to deal with playback performance issues. Film scans are typically delivered as either a ProRes MOV or a sequence of DPX stills. Each of these files represents a single scan frame, but Resolve will see these as a single clip because they are named with sequential numbers. For most uses, a ProRes file offers more than enough quality. DPX files offer superior quality, but are more taxing for computers to play back. Today, I'm working with ProRes MOV scans, and I'm going to show you three methods for breaking those large clips down into individual shots. The first method is labor intensive. In the media page, load the scan into the viewer, and then mark in and out points around the first shot. The left and the right cursor keys are really useful for scrubbing the playhead backwards and forwards to make sure you find the exact frame where the scene changes. The keyboard shortcuts I and O can be used to mark in and out points respectively. Then when you drag that clip into the media pool, instead of importing the entire clip, it will create a subclip that contains just that one single shot. You can name your subclips, but it's not necessary. That's pretty easy, but now I need to repeat that with every other shot in this scan. That's going to get tedious. If accuracy is critical, if your cuts have to be frame perfect, then this might be your best option. It can be really time consuming though, so you might find the next option more attractive. I'll delete these clips so I can start again. Method two is quick and dirty. Instead of importing this scan directly into my media pool, I'm going to use Resolve's scene cut detection. Right click on the clip and go to scene cut detection. Then hit auto scene detect. This utility identifies cuts by examining the difference between successive frames in the image. If enough of the image changes, it assumes a cut. On the right, there's a list of all the cuts the tool has detected, and on the left, a visual representation. Cuts are indicated with these green lines. Possible cuts are shown as grey lines. By moving this magenta line up or down, you affect the level of confidence required for the scene cut detector to assume a cut. I've lowered the magenta line to include cuts that Resolve has less confidence in. It looks like it's done a good job of finding the cuts in the scan. However, you might notice that on several shots, instead of a single cut, Resolve has detected several all clustered together. When you stop and start a film camera, you'll often get frame flashes. And if you remove the magazine in between shots, you'll get light leaks. Let me show you an example. This is the 17th cut that's been detected. The large image in the viewer shows what Resolve thinks is the first frame of the new cut that it's detected. The small image in the bottom left shows the previous frame. I can tell this is a false positive because those two images are almost identical. Contrast this with a correctly identified cut, where there is a clear difference between the image in the bottom left and the main image in the viewer. I'm going to deal with these false positives later. For now, I'm going to import the clips. Click Add Cuts to Media Pool, and then close the scene detector. All the clips are now in my media pool. I've got a really simple way of dealing with those false positives. Switch your media pool to list view and order your clips by ascending duration. All of these super short clips are definitely false positives. I can safely assume that anything with a duration under a second or so is junk that I can get rid of. I'll select all those super short clips and press delete. I told you this would be quick, but because I've not manually checked all of those cuts, there will be some errors in there. Hopefully not too many, but perhaps I've lost a couple of frames off the beginning or the end of a clip. Or if something passed in front of the camera in the middle of a shot, the scene cut detection might have falsely assumed that that was a cut in the shot and split a clip in half. Now, if accuracy is really important, if you want to make sure there's no mistakes and that you keep all of those beautiful frame flashes and film artifacts at the beginning and the end of the shots, you will want to use method one. Or alternatively, you might enjoy the next method that I'm about to show you. I'll demonstrate the third technique on the next reel of film. Let's do some housekeeping so we can keep our media pool tidy. This time, import the entire uncut scan and pop it into a timeline. In the Edit page, select the clip, go to Timeline, and detect scene cuts. This works similar to the scene cut detection in the Media page, but instead of importing subclips into my media pool, it creates cuts in the timeline. Why is this significant? Because the scene cut detection will have placed cuts where they shouldn't be, those false positives. And personally, I find that the Edit page has a far more intuitive interface for finding those cuts and deleting them. I'll drag my playhead back to the beginning and jump into Detail View. You'll want to use your up and down cursor keys because they allow you to jump between cuts in the timeline. Every time you come across a cut that shouldn't be there, just delete it. Now that I've tidied up all the false positives in this timeline, I have two options. I can edit with these clips by copying them out of this D002 timeline into the timeline where I'm building my edit. Or alternatively, I can create subclips from these edits. One's quick, one's a little bit more robust. I'll turn dual viewers on and open my media pool. Let's start with the first cut in my timeline. Pushing F will load that scan up in the source viewer with in and out points marking the clip that I currently have selected. Option or Alt B will turn those in and out points into a subclip. Again, I'd have to repeat that for every single clip in the timeline. I do have another way of doing that though. It's quicker, but less robust. I'll just quickly delete that subclip that I created. This time, select all the clips in the timeline and simply drag them into your media pool. These aren't proper subclips. They're just copies of the scan, but with in and out points marked on them. Now, this footage has been shot on a 1.5x anamorphic lens. Let's get the footage to display correctly. First, I'll turn color management on, and then set these clips' input color space to Cinian Log. That's the color space that's typically used when scanning film. Next, this footage has been shot on a 1.5x anamorphic lens, so it needs to be de-squeezed. I can set that up in clip attributes. Again, I can configure all of the clips simultaneously. Now, one last thing. Labs often scan the negative with the gate visible. Sometimes they even include perforations in the scan. You can see here in my scan, just the gate is visible. Now, if I drag this clip into my edit, the gate is going to be visible. Perhaps you like that aesthetic and you want the sprockets and the gate visible in your final edit. In this instance, I don't. I want a nice, clean image. So how can I avoid having to manually resize every single clip once I've dragged it into my timeline? Select all of the clips again, and I'm going to open my inspector. Please note, I'm still on the media page. I'm not in the edit page. Perhaps you knew this, perhaps you didn't, but you can change the inspector properties of clips before they've been inserted into your timeline. That way, when you do insert them into the timeline, they'll inherit all of the changes you made in the inspector to the clips while they were in the media pool. Please note, these changes only go in one direction. If I insert a clip into the timeline and then change a property in the media pool inspector, that change won't propagate to the timeline. DPX files are especially hard to playback, but whether you're using ProRes or DPX, if you're getting poor playback performance, what should you do? Use proxies. You might find Natalie's tutorial on the Resolve Proxy Generator helpful. Click on the little banner to go see it. As of filming, the proxy generator doesn't work with DPXs. If you're working with DPX files, you'll need to create your proxies within Resolve. To configure proxies, go to Project Settings, choose your proxy resolution, format, and location. I'd recommend reconfiguring this folder so that your proxies are stored in the same location that the rest of your files are stored. Once you're happy with your settings, right-click on your clips in the media pool and hit Generate Proxies. Awesome. And once this is finished, you're all good to start editing. Don't forget to use your proxies. You'll need to change your proxy handling to Prefer Proxies. Film is still very much alive and is an awesome medium for capturing content. If you have any questions, leave them down below. Subscribe for future content. And if you've made it this far into the video, please give it a like. Thanks for watching.